ibuprofen, mefenamic acid would be of the same kind, because not only my hair are getting grey, but the grey matter is getting white, and therefore I remember only few drugs, because I won't know the dose of mefenamic acid. Okay. That's why I don't try it. But I suppose it is as good or bad. And therefore, I don't mind if somebody says I use mefenamic acid. I'm sure it's as good. But then I'm happy with paracetamol, so I don't even worry about it.
The lukewarm wash, thorough wash, not only brings down the temperature, I feel it enhances the immunity also.
Well, I learned something much more today. Thank you very much.
This is what I routinely do in such situations.
Excellent. I think from tomorrow I'll practice.
I mean, quite
no, I think what you're saying is probably rational, but the point is that we need to use such measures.
And it brightens the baby also.
Yes, because it's very pleasant. You put somebody in that cold water, first thing there's a vasoconstriction and fever doesn't come down. Now if ice doesn't come down, bring down the fever, they will go for dry ice. That's too much. So I think we need to
study the reason. Even in acute distress, people are allowed to take bath.
Yes, I think when we are tired, we take probably a lukewarm water bath and we feel happy. I suppose the muscles which are tired certainly enhance the circulation, remove the toxins, and you feel better. So there must be a reason to make the baby more comfortable, but also, as you say, even enhance immunity.
Yes. Well, regarding the ibuprofen, sir, I have seen a child about 1 year plus. I resisted myself from giving ibuprofen, and I gave one dose. The child reported with bleeding, gastric bleeding.
Well, I'm sure that these must be occasional things happening, and while paracetamol is far safer, I'm sure the other NSAIDs may have small problems, and I think the nephrologist would certainly not like any NSAIDs to be used in general, though fortunately we don't need to use long-term NSAIDs, but I think paracetamol is the safest.
I think in one of the sessions, I remember Dr. Srinivasan said high temperature over 103 and with leukocytosis, straight away you can go for an antibiotic.
I think I mentioned occult bacteremia in children between 3 months to 3 years of age, and it's one of the screening method, and then that is the way you have to decide about. That is accepted the other thing. We remember Kadalur, that's ceftriaxone. That's occult bacteremia in that particular age group, where we have done one study which has been published also. So that is one way, instead of starting antibiotic in that particular age group where there is a risk of pyogenic meningitis in a few percentage of cases, about 6% of cases, then it has to be used. And of course Dr. Amdekar also has written in the emergency medicine about fear of unknown origin. So I think that is the recommendation.
I personally feel that if you time your test properly, you can interpret it better. In Bombay today, every head injury in a child is first CT scan, because there are so many CT scan centers, you are likely to fall near the CT scan center. Okay. And first you do a CT scan and then go to a doctor with a normal CT scan. After 12 hours, you are getting drowsy. But you say, but CT scan was normal. I said, brain was not normal, CT scan was normal. So, I think sometimes the test has to be timed, and I personally feel that if I don't suspect a serious disease underlying causing fever, then I would wait for first 48 hours, even before rushing. I might do a routine urinalysis on day one. I think in a small baby with high fever, that's my first bet of a routine urinalysis, not even a CBC.
Sir, I see more number of febrile seizures around the new moon or full moon days. Is it that? It is my observation over the...
Pardon?
I see more number of febrile seizures.
I didn't get him.
High number of febrile seizures during new moon or full moon days. New moon or full moon days.
I think if you add new moon or no moon and some parrot moon, then it would be true. Because I'm sure that the science may recognize some changes occurring in environment which we don't understand. And there are people who say, I get an asthmatic episode every time. Okay, there I tell the parents that if you have observed it, what will happen if you get an asthmatic attack at some other day? Will you treat or not? Yes. But I am sure this is a thing that we don't know. If you really broadly see three paths, allopathics as we practice, we are after getting rid of the enemy. So we talk of bacteria, virus, fungus, etc. The homeopath talk about the host. They say even if America comes with a nuclear bomb, we will have our lathi or something ready. We will create a host competent. And the Ayurvedic physician talk of environment. They would say get up in the morning before sunrise, take a bath and take this medicine. Okay. I think all three are important. We are rather ignorant about the other two. We are doing a host study. We are talking about immunocompromised, immunocompetent. So I think we are bringing in that. We are also talking about the environment. We know rifampicin early in the morning on empty stomach. We do talk. We talk about circadian rhythm. So I suppose that all along we gave an attention to only the enemy. Now allopaths are also giving a lot of attention to the host and the environment, of which we know little. I'm sure Ayurvedic physicians know more about diet and disease rather than we know. But we need to take from that. So I suppose there could be something true in this statement, but I don't know scientifically whether it could be considered as that. If that is so, then I'll give an oral diazepam or a frisium 12 hours prior and another day, so that would be.
Because of the risk of emesis, what has been the experience of the risk of emesis exists as Dr. Virudhagiri has said.
Well, UNICAM earlier days when Mr. Modi was reigning supreme, he wanted to bring in a lot of suppositories, including bitter drug like chloroquine, etc. And a market survey had shown suppositories that the rectal mucosa absorbs the drug, especially certain drugs, as quick as an IV. And therefore, if you push an IV diazepam, it would be as good as a rectal diazepam. I can understand a simple febrile seizure. When you are seeing a child seizuring, you could push even an intravenous preparation through a catheter per rectum. It will act as good. So there is an advantage of a quicker absorption through a rectal mucosa, especially in some drugs. Barring that, I think oral is far more convenient.
We have a group of children who refuse to take medicines. So for them, I think suppository, especially in fever.
Yeah.
We've had some children who refuse to take any medicine. So in those cases, probably suppository would be of use.
Yes, but I know some of my family physician friends who give injection because children don't like to take medications. Now, you can't give injection of nutrients. Okay, they have to use their mouth. So I feel that largely, I find that most of the mothers, and you are a better judge, know how to give any drug to her child. Okay, if the nurse comes and if I say, do it this way, that way, it may not be right. So, personally, I feel even chloroquine, I have almost never used it in any other way except orally. And I'm sure most of you have done the same and successfully.
Sir, only one question, sir. Regarding parental pressures, how do you manage, apart from the referral, other ways to manage parental pressures?
Parental pressure? I think the best way to manage any pressure is to pressurize the opponent. Okay. And I think what we lack is a confidence in ourselves. Okay. When the parents ask me, are you sure? I said, I'm not sure. Then they look at me, then why are you talking? I said, I'm honest. Yeah. To the best of my honest ability, I have given you an advice. It may not be right. Find out who can give you the right advice all the time. Okay, but I tell them that honest advice is usually right. Okay, yeah, and I think that's the way you keep the parents mum. And yeah, when I say this, they don't know where to look at. Then they say, better get out and follow this man because he will talk something more. So I seriously mean that you rarely fail to convince a parent if you try your best and be confident. Okay. And finally, never argue. You say, but so-and-so doctor always gave medicine. That is his view. He may be right, he may be better, but this is my view. I put it on black and white. I think when you say that, when I say no antibiotic, I write it down. And I tell them that if somebody writes an antibiotic, please ask him to write why he has written an antibiotic. I think the message goes very clear. That they come out and say, no, my doctor says this is enough. Okay, name of the child and two antibiotics, enough. Because after all, chemist doesn't need to know for what you have given.
Sir, whether paracetamol is safe in acute viral hepatitis?
In the first instance, in a viral hepatitis, typically you don't need much of antipyretic. But if you need one, you can choose a physical measures, or even then you can use a paracetamol. Okay, it's a paracetamol poisoning. The trouble is, in Western world, they don't have TIC-20, an easily available suicidal agent. So therefore, they have paracetamol as a suicidal agent. Here, who wants to take 50 tablets of paracetamol to die? You have many better agents. So I think paracetamol is safe. Western literature highlights the toxicity, fatality, all that is either accidental, more often intentional. I would say paracetamol is safe even in viral hepatitis. Well, if he's in a hepatocellular failure, then that's a different story. Virally rarely does that. I imagine you don't need an antipyretic. When you need, you can use physical measures. If you need at the end of that to use paracetamol, it won't come.
So at the height of fever, the children doesn't tolerate the moist cloth used for tepid sponging. I think I would suggest the mother's wet hands to smear thin film of water and let it evaporate. These children may tolerate well the mother's hands, moist hands, rather than the cloth that is put on the children. Many children, they get irritated and once the cloths are put on, moist cloth, when the at the height of fever.
Fine. I think the principle is same. What you are trying to say with your observation, that you have a different modality of putting the same principle in implementation, I think perfectly fine.
So regarding blood culture, sir, what's the right time to take blood culture? Whether
for me, blood... Sorry.
No,
don't
sir.
Ask me too many questions. Sir.
Blood culture should be taken whether the patient at the time of temperature or after the temperature settles.
Blood culture?
Yeah.
Oh, blood culture you can take at any time. It doesn't matter when you take. But for me, a blood culture is a 4-day fever, getting higher, no clue clinically, salmonellosis is probability. If possible, I would send a blood culture. And I would make a point, and I'm sure he may address that issue, that Salmonella is the easiest organism to culture in a bacteriology lab. If your bacteriology lab cannot do that, they should stop bacteriology lab. Yeah, it's not a Haemophilus influenza we are talking about, which is so difficult. Salmonella is easy, provided you are not given an antibiotic, provided you definitely get Salmonella. Okay, and I think we must develop that culture of asking for cultures. Okay, I mean, urine cultures are also often not asked, which is a pity, but blood culture. I don't mind if you don't ask for a culture in pneumonia. But the pneumonia is here and you are expecting the organism to loiter around in the blood there. You are expecting too much. Well, it could be, but it's not a good idea. But a bacteremia, like typhoid, I think what better proof but a culture. But we have already heard him. That culture is not available each time. You go by clinical status, Vidal, etc. Yes. But if you want to do, I think a culture, yes.
So the facilities is not available, it is transported to some other cities, whether it is advisable?
I think ideally not. For example, ideally, I'm sure the best way, if I have a little bigger child who can oblige, I would ask him to go to the lab and pass urine there and let him collect there, write and plate it immediately. The other alternative is you could keep plates as a clinician and plate it right there. I think that may be ideal. Moment you have a transport and time lag, I think you are causing trouble, but you need to do whatever is best. In my urine cultures, I would ask the parents to take the child to a lab and the lab collects it so that they have no reason to say you sent a wrong sample and here is your wrong results. Till what number of days? Oh, till you are sure that there is nothing you are missing. Yeah, I mean, after all, viral infection can go on for a week, if you are sure. But at the end of 4 days, I think you want to be doubly sure, so you would do some preliminary tests. If your blood counts are normal, if your urine analysis is normal, if your chest X-ray is normal, you have already never thought of a meningitis or anything, what more can you prescribe? Just stay put with paracetamol. But surely, 4 days have gone past, you are treading on a little loose grounds, and you need to be very sure whether you are looking at some unusual, rare diseases.
See, viral infections now commonly present everywhere. Infants about 1 to 2 years, presenting with scattered crepitations, little faster breathing, but still not pneumonia, because the criteria of WHO says faster respiratory rate. So are we right, are we rational in not exhibiting antibiotic?
Yeah, I think the WHO criteria are largely not to allow any misdiagnosis of a pneumonia. But in your and my hand, you have an experience to back up, you have a chance of follow-up of a patient the very next day, if need be you have a chance of doing some tests. I think we can be a little more rational in making this statement not every time true. And therefore, what Mahesh said, I would agree that if there is hardly any fever, okay, then it's not a bacterial pneumonia. If there is a high fever and a tachypneic child and a grunting child, then we already said that we don't need anything, it's a pneumonia. So I think largely the WHO protocol ensures that every child of pneumonia is referred quickly for treatment, even when some more are unnecessarily treated. That is to reduce the mortality in the population. You and me have an one-to-one contact with a patient, you and me can do something much better, and if one is sure. But yes, if I'm not sure, I'll follow the protocol. It is safe. If I'm sure, I will ignore the protocol. So to ignore the protocol, I need to be very sure. Otherwise, I follow the protocol, I'm okay. Intravenous paracetamol? No. I'm very poor of getting the veins, so I would not try. Now, I think I don't see any reason for intravenous paracetamol. Physical measures are good enough, oral is excellent. So no intravenous medication.
One glad announcement, Prof. Amdekar is sharing his experience, Lessons Learned from the Grand Rounds. He is releasing a book by name Lessons from the Grand Rounds.